diseases, group of diseases I would call. One is the urinary tract infection, and second is the diarrhea. E. coli causes these two diseases very, very frequently in humans. So today we will study urinary tract or those strains of E. coli which produce diarrhea in humans. First, we will take up urinary tract infections. E. coli is the commonest pathogen which causes urinary tract infections. About 70 to 75% of all cases of UTI are caused by Escherichia coli. The commonest pathogen bacteria causing urinary tract infections. Those strains of E. coli which cause urinary tract infections are called uropathogenic E. coli, UPEC. UPEC stands for uropathogenic Escherichia coli. Now the serotypes which are commonly involved in cases of urinary tract infections, these serotypes are O1, O2, O4, O6, O7 and O75. These are commonest serotypes of uropathogenic E. coli which are responsible for the most cases of urinary tract infections. Now, how does it spread? How it causes UTI? There are two main routes by which bacteria enter human body. One is called ascending route and another is descending route. So there are two routes of infection for E. coli: ascending route or descending route. In ascending route, first these bacteria colonize periurethral area, and from there, from urethra, they reach to bladder, and here they cause cystitis. During their colonization in urethra, they also produce urethritis. And when they reach further ahead, it would infect the kidneys and will cause pyelonephritis. So, by ascending route, they produce mainly three types of clinical manifestations: the infection of bladder, cystitis; infection of urethra, urethritis; and when it goes further, on further ascension, it leads to pyelonephritis. By descending route is the route taken by these bacteria is the blood, hematogenous. It is due to hematogenous seeding in kidneys. When these bacteria are present in blood, there is bacteremia, and these bacteria, they colonize into kidneys, they seed into kidneys, which again results in pyelonephritis. Ascending route is the common route of infection, and descending compared to ascending is not that common. Now I hope it is clear that these bacteria, how they spread in body by ascending and by descending route, producing urethritis, cystitis and pyelonephritis. Okay, now can you see this slide? Now this slide shows the different types of urinary tract infections, and these types, the sites involved, whether it is lower urinary tract or upper urinary tract. So we can conveniently divide urinary tract infections into two groups, lower urinary tract infections and upper urinary tract infections. Lower urinary tract infections, the sites are bladder and urethra. Bladder and urethra are the sites involved in lower UTI, and when there is cystitis or urethritis, the clinical symptoms produced are dysuria, there is urgency and frequency of micturition. In lower UTI, the organ involved are bladder and urethra, producing cystitis, urethritis, and the clinical symptoms are dysuria, urgency, and frequency of micturition. Again, the root is ascending. They spread by ascending root. It is the most common and virulence factors are Fimbria P. These are the fimbria which colonize the periurethral area. Now we come to the upper urinary tract infections. Here the sites are kidneys and ureter, causing pyelonephritis. And as you know, pyelonephritis or kidney infections mainly are caused by hematogenous root, where these bacteria present in blood. They seep into kidneys and produce pyelonephritis. Symptoms are fever, vomiting, abdominal pain, local and systemic manifestations. Route of spread is ascending, but by descending route, both routes are able to produce pyelonephritis. Upper UTI compared to lower UTI is less common. Virulence factors involved are capsular or K antigen. Capsular or K antigen, it is responsible for causing upper UTI or pyelonephritis, infection of kidneys and ureters. Now, this slide shows the toxins which are mainly responsible for causing both lower urinary tract infections or upper respiratory tract infections. So, these are three important toxins produced by Escherichia coli, mainly responsible for urinary tract infections. These toxins are cytotoxin. This fraction of cytotoxin called cytotoxic necrotizing factor. Cytotoxic necrotizing factor. This is the one toxin. Second is hemolysin. And then secreted autotransport toxin, which is again part of cytotoxin. So mainly remember these three cytotoxins produced by E. coli, especially cytotoxic necrotizing factor and secreted autotransport toxin. These two cytotoxins and then hemolysins. These are the toxins or virulence factors responsible for both lower and upper urinary tract infections. Now, this slide shows predisposing factors that promote UTI. Predisposing factors that promote UTI. UTI is comparatively common in females to males. In females, due to short length of urethra, ascending infections are common. Also, there is close proximity to anus. These two factors mainly cause UTI and make females more prone to get UTI. Second is presence of urinary catheters. Especially in hospitalized patients, the statistics shows that all those patients who have been catheterized, 7 out of 10 get urinary tract infections. 7 out of 10 patients who need urinary catheter for maturation, they get. It means about 70%, 60 to 70% of the patients which are catheterized, they get urinary tract infections. Third is those persons who have obstruction, urinary obstruction, such as enlarged prostate or urinary stone. Both enlarged prostate and urinary stones, they lead to stasis of urine. Because of the enlarged prostate, there is pressure on the urethra and there is no full voiding of urine. So some amount of urine is left in the bladder, and because of this stasis of urine, infections occur. Similarly, in urinary stones also, there is stasis of urine. It's not full voiding of urine. Pregnancy is another physiological condition in which there is prolonged stasis of urine because of the growing fetus that leads to the stasis of urine and therefore predisposes to urinary tract infections. Again, in pregnant women, asymptomatic bacteriuria is common. It means they have infection, bacteria are present, but there are no symptoms. Condition is also called subclinical bacteriuria or subclinical urinary tract infection. It's quite common in females. Now we come to laboratory laboratory diagnosis of uropathogenic E. coli. Laboratory diagnosis of uropathogenic E. coli. Now the first specimen collection. So how to collect urine? Clean voided midstream urine is collected. Clean voided midstream urine collected after proper cleaning of urethral meatus or glands. Important to remember, clean voided midstream urine after proper disinfecting or cleaning urethral meatus or glands. We can take suprapubic aspiration also from bladder, and this route, this way of collecting urine, suprapubic aspiration from bladder, it is the most ideal specimen and is recommended for infants and coma patients especially. Suprapubic aspiration for infants and for coma patients. In hospitals, when the patients are catheterized, we should collect urine from tube after cleaning it and disinfecting it, but never from the bag. Never from the bag. In catheterized patient, collect urine from the tube. But before that, clean and disinfect the tube. Now, next slide. Transport of urine specimen. Transport of urine specimen. It should be processed immediately. But if delay is expected for more than 1 to 2 hours, then we can safely refrigerate urine at 4 degrees centigrade. Now, if we have to keep it for 24 hours, then it is better to add boric acid or glycerol or formate for maximum 24 hours. So the preservatives which are used in case of urine samples, these are boric acid, glycerol and formate. But if for 1 to 2 hours, then you can refrigerate it at 4 degrees centigrade. So urine should be refrigerated maximum up to 24 hours. But the best is that it should be processed as soon as possible, immediately. Next slide. Now we come to the direct examination of urine. As soon as the sample urine is received in laboratory, what we do is we examine the urine directly. First is the wet mount examination. We take a drop of 2-3 drops of urine on the slide, put cover slip and examine directly. Now, what do we look for in the direct examination of urine? That is wet mount examination. Number one, we look for the pus cells. Number two, we look for the presence of bacteria. Number three, we look for red blood cells, RBCs, and then different type of casts and crystals. So these things are examined by wet mount. Presence of 0 to 4 pus cells per high power field is considered normal. We find that 4 to 5 or 4 or less than 4, 2, 3, these number of pus cells are commonly shed in normal persons. Similarly, presence of RBCs, 0 to 4 RBCs also are commonly shed in urine in normal healthy individuals. Also, epithelial cells, these are again 0 to 4 epithelial cells per high power field are normal. Again, pus cells 0 to 4 are considered normal. More than 4, 6 to 10 per high power field, they are indicative of infections. Usually, in cases of pyuria, where there is pus in the urine or pus cells in the urine, more than 9-10 pus cells per high power field, they indicate pyuria and also they indicate infection. I hope it is clear. It is important to remember. Wet mount examination for pus cells, for RBCs, for bacteria and for other cells, casts and crystals. There is another test very commonly done, which is also a cheaper method and commonly employed. This test is called leukocyte esterase test. Leukocyte esterase test. This test can be done very rapidly. Also, it is cheap. And here we, in this test, we try to find leukocyte esterases, which are secreted by pus cells. If pus cells are present in the urine, they would secrete leukocyte esterase, and this presence of leukocyte esterase we find in urine, and if we find this, it means there is infection. Third is nitrate reduction test. Now all those bacteria which belong to family Enterobacteriaceae, and E. coli is the one which belongs to this family, and in its biochemical reaction, now you can recall that all bacteria, these are gram-negative bacteria, they reduce nitrate to nitrites. So we can perform this reduction test known as Grease test. Grease test. It finds out the reduction of nitrate to nitrites and E. coli shows this biochemical reaction. So this grease test will come positive, which again indicates this is the infection. Then, like other fluid or exudates, we perform gram staining in laboratory. One can perform gram staining for urine specimen, but it is not a reliable indicator because the number of bacteria present in urine, they are usually very low in number. And then again, pus cells which are present in urine, they also deteriorate. Is not a reliable method for bacterial count in urine. It is very low. And pus cells also, they deteriorate very rapidly. And therefore, gram staining is not of much use. But in cases of pyelonephritis or invasive urinary tract infections, because of the enormous number of pus cells, we can perform gram staining. Next. Now the culture methods. How do we culture Escherichia coli in urine specimen? The media most commonly used are McConkie agar and blood agar. In place of McConkie agar, one can use CLED medium also. The full name is cysteine lactose electrolyte deficient agar. But the commonest media used to grow this gram-negative bacteria Escherichia coli is McConkie agar and blood agar. Now, what is significant bacteriuria? During culture or growth of Escherichia coli or any gram-negative bacteria, especially when we culture urine, this is of great significance. That is the how many colonies we see on agar medium. This significant bacteriuria refers to that normal urine is sterile, but during voiding or during collection of urine specimen, it gets contaminated with normal urethral flora, which is very common. Now, contaminated urine will have lower bacterial count than that which is caused by infection. Contaminated urine will have lower bacterial count. So, the count of more than or equal to 10^5 colony forming units, CFU, colony forming units per ml of urine is considered significant and indicates infection. So, a count of more than or equal to 10^5 colonies per ml of urine are considered significant and indicate infection. Count between 10^4 and 10^5 is doubtful, and count lower than 10^4 is usually considered that it is due to commensal bacteria or due to some contamination while urine sample was taken. So the significant bacteriuria is a count of more than or equal to 10^5 CFU or colony forming units per ml of urine is considered significant, and less than that, between 10^4 and 10^5 is doubtful, and less than 10^4 number of colonies per ml of urine is due to commensal bacteria or due to the contamination during collection of the sample. But in some cases, low count may be considered significant. So in following conditions, like when patient is on antibiotics or diuretic treatment, patient on antibiotics or diuretic treatment, the count will be low in urine. Infection with gram-positive bacteria, especially Staphylococcus aureus or a fungi called Candida, so count will be again very low in these cases. Then in cases of pyelonephritis and acute urethral syndrome, and when we take sample from suprapubic aspiration, the counts are usually low than 10^5 CFU per ml of urine, but still considered significant. Now, there are two methods of culture where we can count colonies on agar plate. One is quantitative culture. Quantitative culture refers to that here we count number of colonies and each colony corresponds to one bacterium in urine sample. The quantitation, how we do the quantitation? It is done by semi-quantitative method such as standardized loop technique or quantitative method such as pore plate method. So these two quantitative and semi-quantitative techniques are used to count the colonies per ml of urine. Commonly in laboratories, we usually employ a standardized loop technique. Here, in one loop, how much urine amount is there? Usually it is 0.03 or 0.05 ml per loop. And then one colony is multiplied by 100 or 1000, whatever the quantity we have taken in the loop. And then we calculate the number of colonies accordingly. Then pore plate method is also where we know the amount of urine, how much is there. And accordingly, the growth we see and count the colonies by a counting chamber. And this is how we come to know whether it is significant bacteriuria or insignificant bacteriuria. Count is equal to or more than 10^5 or less than that. So these are the two methods commonly employed to count the numbers of bacteria. Now this slide shows a test called antibody-coated bacterial test. This test is done to differentiate lower and upper UTI. We have seen that in upper UTI, the route of spread is hematogenous, and therefore these bacteria are usually coated with a specific antibody and they are found in urine. Such bacteria are detected by immunofluorescent method using fluorescent labeled anti-human globulin. So, antibody-coated bacterial test detects presence of specific antibodies which coat the bacteria, and it is because the route of spread is hematogenous. Therefore, in hematogenous route spread, especially in cases of upper UTI, we find bacteria which are coated with a specific antibody, and the technique by which we detect is immunofluorescent technique. Here we use fluorescent labeled anti-human globulin. If these specific antibodies are found in urine coated on bacteria, then it shows it is upper urinary tract infection. And in lower UTI, because there is no contact with the blood, there is no hematogenous spread, it is the ascending route. So in lower UTI, bacteria are not coated with specific antibodies, and therefore this test will be negative. Now this finishes our urinary tract infections caused by Escherichia coli. Now we come to diarrheagenic E. coli which cause diarrhea in humans. Now these E. coli which produce diarrhea are antigenically distinct from commensal E. coli, which colonize the intestines. As we had talked about it, that not all E. coli cause urinary tract infections or diarrhea. There are only few serotypes, few strains of Escherichia coli responsible for these two diseases. Here, diarrhea are produced by those E. coli which are antigenically different, distinct from the commensal E. coli present in human gut. Only few serotypes of E. coli which express the enterotoxin. This is important. Only those E. coli which can produce enterotoxin or they have other virulence mechanisms causing diarrhea, only those E. coli are called diarrheagenic E. coli. There are mainly six types of diarrheagenic E. coli: EPEC, enteropathogenic E. coli; ETEC, enterotoxigenic E. coli; EIEC, enteroinvasive E. coli; EHEC, enterohemorrhagic E. coli; EAEC, enteroaggregative E. coli; and DAEC is diffusely adherent E. coli. Diffusely adherent E. coli. Now, first we will talk about the enteropathogenic E. coli. Enteropathogenic E. coli. It causes diarrhea mainly in infants, infantile diarrhea of intestinal mucosa, and therefore it causes increased. There are cup-like projections called pedestals. Then these lesions are called AE lesions. Because of the disruption of the breast border of the epithelium, there is increased secretion, which results in watery diarrhea in case of Escherichia coli, enteropathogenic strains of Escherichia coli. Now, we come to the second one, that is called enterotoxigenic E. coli. Enterotoxigenic E. coli. Now, this enterotoxigenic E. coli commonly causes traveler's diarrhea, known as traveler's diarrhea. Especially Westerners, when they visit our continent, an Asian country, especially in Southeast Asia, these cases of traveler's diarrhea is very commonly seen. So, enterotoxigenic E. coli, they are the most common cause of traveler's diarrhea, causing about 25 to 75% of all cases. There is acute watery diarrhea, especially in infants and also in adults. The common serotypes which cause traveler's diarrhea, these are O6, O8, O15, O25, O27, O153, O159, etc. ETEC, as the name indicates, enterotoxigenic, it is toxigenic, but it is not invasive. So the mechanism of diarrhea would mainly be on production of toxin and how this toxin acts. So the mechanism of action, these organisms attach to intestinal mucosa, and this attachment is mediated by fimbrial protein called CFA, or colonization factor antigen. So this attachment to the intestinal mucosa is mediated by colony-forming antigens. Now, ETEC produces two types of enterotoxin: heat labile toxin and heat stable toxin. About these toxins, we had talked in the last class in detail that how they produce diarrhea. However, LT, or the heat labile toxin, it acts by increased cyclic adenosine monophosphate. There is increase in cyclic AMP. And in cases of heat stable toxin, there is an increase in guanosine monophosphate cycle, or CGMP. This is how in ETEC, the enterotoxin, heat labile and heat stable, both are responsible for causing diarrhea. Now, the detection of this toxin is the mainstay of diagnosis. We can diagnose ETEC cases by latex agglutination test and ELISA by finding these toxins. Then molecular method like PCR, which detects gene coding for heat labile toxin, can also be employed. The commonest are latex agglutination and ELISA tests. Now we come to the third type of E. coli. These are called enteroinvasive E. coli. These are called enteroinvasive E. coli or EIEC. The common serotypes which are associated with EIEC are O28, O112, O114, O124, O136, O5 and O52, etc. These are the serotypes associated with enteroinvasive E. coli. It is again non-toxigenic, but as the name indicates, enteroinvasive, so they are invasive. The epithelial cell is invaded by these bacteria. Epithelial cell invasion, again it is plasmid mediated, and the antigen which they produce is called virulence marker antigen or VMA. Virulence marker antigen is mainly responsible for the epithelial cell invasion by EIEC or enteroinvasive E. coli. So how EIEC causes diarrhea, how it causes this infection is due to the presence of VMA or virulence marker antigen. This antigen is mainly responsible for the invasion of epithelial cells of intestine. Now these invasive strains are biochemically, genetically and pathogenically closely related to another important organism of Enterobacteriaceae family, that is Shigella. Shigella produces bacillary dysentery, and the antigen produced by Shigella or virulence marker produced by Shigella, EIEC almost have the same antigen, same toxin, biochemically, genetically and pathogenically very closely related to Shigella. Now, clinical manifestations of EIEC infection, there is an ulceration of bowel, naturally invasive, so it will cause the formation of ulcers, and there is dysentery, that is diarrhea with mucus and blood. So far we studied enteropathogenic, enterotoxigenic. Their diarrhea was not associated with mucus and blood. In invasive E. coli, enteroinvasive E. coli, it causes dysentery where the stool is mixed with mucus and blood. Laboratory diagnosis can be done by ELISA, and what we try to find out in the sample is the virulence marker antigen or VMA. Also, there is one test known as Sereny test, which is also done for the diagnosis of EIEC. Now, this Sereny test is, we inoculate bacterial suspension in guinea pig eyes. Bacterial suspension in guinea pig eyes, and this will produce conjunctivitis. This is called Sereny test. Sereny test. This test is done for the diagnosis of EIEC or enteroinvasive E. coli. Also, we can use the different cell lines such as HeLa cell lines, and these HeLa cells are invaded by these EIEC because they produce this virulence marker antigen, which is responsible for epithelial cell invasion. Now, another important thing about this strain EIEC is that they are atypical E. coli. They are atypical E. coli because these enteroinvasive strains of E. coli, they are, number one, they are non-motile. as we know that all E. coli are motile. But here EIEC, intro-invasive E. coli are non-motile. Again, they are non-lactose fermenters. They are NLF, non-lactose fermenters. While we see all other strains of E. coli are lactose fermenters. And also, they are negative for lysine decarboxylase test. Lysine decarboxylase test. So, it is interesting to note that these particular strains, EIEC strains of E. coli, these are atypical called because they are non-motile and they are non-lactose fermenters. Now, this slide shows enterohemorrhagic E. coli, EHEC, enterohemorrhagic E. coli. Now, this again, enterohemorrhagic E. coli, in contrast to other E. coli infections, this type of infection caused by EHEC is mainly prevalent in developed countries. In developed countries, not in developing, but developed countries. Serotypes which are associated with enterohemorrhagic E. coli are O157H7. Very important to remember, EHEC, enterohemorrhagic E. coli, serotype most responsible for this hemorrhagic E. coli infection. This serotype is O157H7. Other rarely associated are O26H11, O6, O45, O11 and O30. But here very important to remember that hemorrhagic diarrhea caused by enterohemorrhagic E. coli, the main serotype is O157H7. It is usually transmitted by contaminated food like lettuce, spinach, sprouts and undercooked ground beef. Infective dose again is very low. 10^2 bacilli may initiate infection like Shigella. Pathogenesis. These hemorrhagic E. coli, they secrete a toxin called virocytotoxin or Shiga-like toxin. This we had talked in the last class about this toxin. Again, I tell you, it acts by inhibiting the protein synthesis by inhibiting 28 ACE subunits of 60 S ribosomes. 28 S subunits of 60 ribosomes. Now, this virocytotoxin, as again, we'll just take up last class, we studied this, STX1 and STX2. STX2 is more commonly associated with development of HUS than STX, hemolytic uremic syndrome. This toxin has predilection for endothelial cells, causing capillary microangiopathy. Now, this leads to clinical manifestations of hemorrhagic colitis, there is gross bloody diarrhea with abdominal pain, fecal leukocytosis, but there is no fever. This is important to remember. In this case, there is no fever. Fever is typically absent. Then in hemolytic uremic syndrome, there is injury to small vessels of kidney and brain, which can again lead to thrombocytopenia, renal failure, encephalopathy, but again without fever. It is common in children. Now, diagnosis can be done. We can detect fecal toxin detection by ELISA, and also we can demonstrate presence of cytotoxins on vero cell lines. We can culture on sorbitol McConkie agar. Now, especially sorbitol McConkie agar is used for O157H7 strain. And here we find pale yellow colonies on this medium because these strains of E. coli, EHEC strains, are sorbitol non-fermenters. And we can use another special media known as rainbow agar. O15 strains appear as black colonies as they are negative for beta-glucuronidase. This rainbow agar can also be used and produces black colonies of especially O15 strains. Then we can use PCR. Now this would differentiate gene coding for STX1 or STX2. Now we come to enteroaggregative E. coli, EAEC. EAEC, enteroaggregative E. coli. It is so named because it adheres to HEP2 cells in a distinct pattern, that is layering of bacteria which are aggregated in a staked brick fashion. Now the pathogenesis, there is intestinal colonization, and again it is mediated by aggregative adhesion fimbria 1, which is regulated by aggregative RG. It also produces Enteroaggregative heat stable enterotoxin, EAEC, produces a toxin called EAST1. EAST stands for enteroaggregative heat stable enterotoxin. Now, clinically, the disease is manifested by persistent acute diarrhea, especially seen in developing countries. E. coli strain 104H4 is enteroaggregative strain responsible for major outbreaks in Germany in 2011. This strain peculiarly produces Shiga-like toxins and can cause hemolytic uremic syndrome. Now we come to the last one. DAEC are diffusely adherent E. coli, and they are characterized by their ability to adhere to HEP2 cells in a diffused pattern, and therefore they are called diffusely adherent Escherichia coli. These bacteria, they express diffuse adherence fimbria. Which contribute to the pathogenesis by attaching to the epithelial cells. Now, this diffusely adherent E. coli is capable of causing diarrheal disease primarily in children between the age of 2 and 6 years. Now we come to the part treatment. Mainly in these diarrheagenic E. coli infections, the mainstay of treatment is fluid replacement therapy, not antibiotics. This is important to remember. The mainstay of treatment in case of E. coli diarrhea, it is fluid replacement therapy, and use of antimicrobials should generally be avoided. But hospital strains, when they cause infection, so we see that in hospital strains usually are MDR, multi-drug resistant strains. When infections are caused in the hospital and these are multi-drug resistant E. coli, then antimicrobials, antibiotics such as carbapenem, amikacin, and beta-lactamase inhibitors combination like piperacillin and tazobactam or cefaparazone or selbactam are usually drug of choice. Polymyxin and fosfomycin are next line of antimicrobials, especially when we come across these diarrheal infections which are hospital strains, so they are usually multi-drug resistant. In that case, we give antibiotics like carbapenem, amikacin, or beta-lactamase inhibitors such as piperacillin-tazobactam combination or cefaparazole or selbactam combination. Second line of drugs are polymyxin and fosfomycin. Now this finishes our E. coli.